Peter, many viewers want to know whether this market is totally different, whether your old view that people should find, buy, and hold good stocks is no longer applicable. What do you think?
I think the same rules applied 50 years ago, applied 5 years ago, apply 20 years from now. Yeah. First of all, you have to know what you own, whether it's a fund or a stock, and you have to have a reason for it. And you ought to be able to explain to an 11-year-old in 2 minutes or less why you own this. And this sucker's going up is not a good reason. I've tried that one. It's not a, doesn't work.
Speak to the question of trust, which Marty just expressed considerable concern about it. I did at the opening. Right. What do you think it's going to take to repair it?
Time. I think it's, this is really terrible this week, what you mentioned about WorldCom and Anderson. I mean, these are real problems, but you just have to have faith. I mean, we've had this before. I think it's going to take time to heal. This is very serious.
What do you think the antidote is to make sure we get rid of these abuses?
I think, you know, people will be punished for it. I think there'll be surveillance. I think board of directors is going to be more careful. I think this is what's happened after you've had an incredible economic boom, a lot of easy money around. People push the envelope. It's sad. It's a, you can't legislate integrity.
What would you say to investors now who say, Peter, everything I own's gone down. It's been going down now for a couple of years.
Right.
People keep saying we're at a bottom.
Right.
Should I get out and go into CDs or gold bars and opium or whatever?
Right, right. Well, basically, you look now, you have three choices. I think if you're an investor, you can put your money in a money market fund and get 1.7, 1.5, 1.6, and it's taxed at a 40% rate. Or you can buy a 10-year treasury and get 4.7, and that's taxed at a 40% rate. Or you can have some equities. And I think stocks over the next 10 years will do a lot better than 4.7 or 1.7. So I would have some of my money. Now, it's up to the person to decide how much they want to have in the stock market. For some people, 10% is aggressive. For some people, 50% is the right amount. It's a personal decision. And you can't go by these rules that if you're 25, you should be 100%. And if you're 45, you should be 50%. And if you're 60, you should be zero. And I guess burping a lot. I don't know what the rules are on people at 60, but I hate those rules. I think they're pathetic.
Why are you confident that stocks will be a lot higher in 10 years?
Well, they're not lottery tickets. I mean, when you own a stock, it's a share of a company. And I think companies are going to make a lot more money in 10 years, a lot more money in 20 years. And that's why they go up. That's the only reason. Some companies don't do well. Xerox is making a lot less money than they did 30 years ago. It's a lot less. But more companies are earning a lot more money than they were. And that's why stocks go up. Corporate profits have gone up 40-fold since World War II. Stock market's up 40-fold.
It's 25 years since you started running Magellan. You had been director of research for Fidelity. You'd been with them since, I guess, 69. What are the most conspicuous mistakes you've seen investors make?
Well, I think not looking at the balance sheet, and this is a mistake I've made. If you look at a person's balance sheet, you look to see what the assets they own, their houses, if they own a house, if they own a car, what debt they have, and take that away, that's what your net worth is. You should do that with a company. And I've seen investors look at companies. Looking at two companies, they're very depressed. They're each at $4 a share. But one company's, and they're each losing a couple million dollars a quarter. One company has $100 million in cash and no debt. And one company has no cash and $100 million in debt. They're about to blow taps on the second company. So you could do this. If you get through eighth grade math and you get anywhere near 8 and 8 equals 16, you can do this. Look at a company's financial position. It's impossible to go bankrupt if you don't have any debt. I mean, you get the Irving G. Thalberg Lifetime Achievement Award. I think they're a bad match. I mean, how could you do that?
When you were actively managing money, you presumably were under the same pressures as other fund managers to show performance results.
Right.
Did that incline you to sell too quickly sometimes?
Well, I think my greatest mistakes are, I mean, you know, it's funny, on a stock, all you can lose is 100%. I've done that. But your great mistakes are selling a good company, and then it doubles, then it triples, and it quadruples, because you make a lot of mistakes. And so those ones that go up tenfold, I call them the 10 baggers. So some of my mistakes are just saying, oh my God, this stock is too high, and I was wrong. And you had to figure out, what inning am I in this baseball game? I sold Toys R Us way too early. It went up 20-fold after I sold. I did the same thing at Home Depot. Those are probably my two greatest mistakes I ever made.
When should you sell?
Well, you ought to find out why you bought a stock. If you're saying it's a cyclical company and they're doing poorly, and they're doing awful, you wait till things are getting better, and they're doing terrific, and then you sell it. But with a growth company, you have to say, Walmart's case, 10 years after they went public, you could have bought the stock and made 500 times your money. Because they still are only in 15% of the United States. And they could say, why can't they go to 17? Why can't they go to 19? Why can't they go to 23? So for the next four decades, they're around the country. So you have to say to yourself, in this stock, I have a 10-year story, a 20-year story. You ought to be able to write that down and follow that. And that's what I do with the company. And that's your decision. That's how you sell it.
We have a novel element for many investors today in the trust issue.
Yes.
We also have security problems that we didn't traditionally have in America. Have they changed the way you pick and believe in stocks?
No, you still buy a company, and you buy a company to grow. And if it's a textile company or it's an electronics company, a software company, you better understand what they do. And if they do well, the stock will do well, no matter what happens to the market. If the Dow Jones today was 1,000 or 500, you would have made a lot of money in McDonald's. You would have made a lot of money in Johnson & Johnson. You would have made a lot of money in Gillette. These companies' earnings have gone up a lot the last 30 years. And if the market was 50,000, you would have lost money in Burlington Industries. I recommended that in 1969. I think it's gone from 34 to 2 with no stock splits because the earnings have been terrible.
Well, your modesty actually makes an important point, which is people with the best batting averages in the world don't bat 1,000. Yeah. I sometimes get angry mail, particularly during bear markets, saying so-and-so recommended such and such and it went down. Yeah. Well, how often did you come up with a clinker?
Well, this is a funny business. You don't have to be right even 5 times out of 10. If the times you're right, you make a double and triple. It offsets all those times you lose 20 or 30%. So when you buy a stock, you ought to say to yourself, how much can I lose and how much can I make? And you ought to be able to make a lot. Because stocks are risky. I mean, look at how much we lost in AT&T. Look at how much we lost in Xerox. These were quality companies. You know, you could lose a lot in a stock. So you got to say to yourself, how much can I make? Because I want to buy a stock. If I'm right, I'm going to make a double or triple.
Does your own confidence ever get shaken?
Every day I think the market's going to go up. You know, I keep calling a lot my company, so I keep calling the company.
You once said to me that you spent all your time looking at companies, analyzing them as businesses, and you didn't spend a lot of time worrying about the economy. Do you have a view on the economy now?
Well, I look at the economy. I look historically at the economy. I don't look at the future. I mean, that's weather forecasting. I look at the economy backwards, see what's happening. And the economy looks very good to me right now. The housing market looks terrific. I mean, the auto market looks good. The consumer looks good. There's a lot of good elements to it. And if this is, we've had 9 recessions since World War II, and they've averaged usually about a 2% decline in the workforce. You know, it's terrible. There's about 1.5 million people have lost their jobs in this decline. But that would only be about a 1% decline in the workforce. So far, this has been a mild recession. It has been mild in technology. It has been mild in telecom. It has been mild for, you know, if the company's making fiber optics. But it's been a normal recession. And I would never bet against the American economy. It's powerful.
You were never a big fan of the technology group, are you now?
I've actually started looking. I'm a little early on these things. I started looking at, in January and February, and I've been researching the companies. They're very complex because they're if there's 1,000 technology companies, they're all a little bit different. They're not like a bunch of banks that are very similar. So you have to be careful. I'm looking at companies that are selling close to cash, they're an industry leader, and they're down 95%.
All our panelists are a little different, too. Let's turn it over to them, starting with Marty Zweig.
Well, let's talk about a little different market. First, we had a bubble here in NASDAQ. It collapsed. It went down about as much as the Japanese market did. The economy is iffy. Some people are comparing our situation now to Japan, God forbid, 10 years ago. What do you think?
Well, I think that's a very interesting correlation. I mean, the Japanese market and economy has been incredibly weak. They've had a 12-year recession. But there, you had a real problem with the banking system. You basically had, let's say, average building, a commercial building went from $50 million to $500 million. A bank then made a 110% loan against it, a $550 million loan. Then the building went back to 50, and they're stuck with a $450 million loan. And the government never cut taxes. It actually raised taxes. I mean, they did everything wrong, and the companies didn't cut costs. So they just sort of sat there, hoped things would get better. Our companies act fast. They start cutting costs real quickly. And our government is, fortunately, this is rare in our history. We went into this recession running a surplus, first time ever. The system's supposed to be, in our country, we should run surpluses in the good times, and then in the bad times, we run deficits. Well, guess what? It's working.
Right.
They didn't have that in Japan. And Japan now has wasted 12 years. I don't think it has all, I don't, this doesn't look to me at all like Japan. We're starting to get better already.
Good. Peter, Lou asked you a question about sort of the typical investor mistakes. And when you started in the business, I know the average investor held mutual funds for, right, you know, 16, 17 years, and now it's down to less than 2 years.
Right.
Do you think that's one of the problems? Have time horizons gotten too short?
Well, I think also they have to say, what do I want? Do I need the money in a year? Do I need the money in 5 years? You're a terrible investor if you need the money in a year. I mean, if you need it for college, to send your kids there, or for a wedding, you're not going to be a good investor. Then you have to do some homework and say, should I have 10 growth funds? That's silly. You say, what do I want? I want 2 or 3 growth funds. What's my mix that I like? And you want to say, is aggressive. You know, some people aggressive is 50%. So I would say people, and some people might want to have foreign funds. It's like a menu in a restaurant. They should look it over and decide what they like and then stay with it. And if one group does well for 2 or 3 years, the next bunch of money they add to, maybe they should add to the group that's underperforming. Over time, different categories work out to be about the same. So you get whipsawed. If you're all in one area, it does poorly for 3 years, you say, get me out of that, and you go into some other area, and that does badly for 3 years, you could be in it forever and never make money.
Peter, does this market remind you of any that you've been through before?
I would say 90, the 90 bear market is very similar in many ways. I mean, just to think Saddam Hussein takes over Kuwait. You know, we send 500,000 troops to Saudi Arabia. All the people are saying it's going to be Iraq's the third largest army in the world. It's going to be another Vietnam. We hit a recession. We had all these banks in trouble. Right now, our banks are in terrific shape, which is a major positive. So that was a very scary environment. And we had defaults. I mean, it was an ugly environment. Everybody was afraid. So I think that was a very similar market. And I think 81, 82 was ugly, too. We had a 20% prime rate, double-digit inflation, double-digit unemployment. So those are scary markets. And then top it all off, the 73, 74 market, as you remember, the Nifty 50, we had that. We had it in technology stocks. So we had 95% declines. And, you know, so we combined three markets into one special case. It's been very fast.
We have less than a minute left. Those who are less sanguine about the economy than you've just expressed often cite the recent declines in the dollar and the shift from surplus to deficit as negatives. You seem to indicate that they're positives. Why?
Well, I think the government running a deficit is terrific. That's the way it should work. I mean, when they were running a $200 billion surplus, which they were, they're taking $200 billion out of the economy. Now the government's running a $100 billion deficit. It's pumping $100 billion in. It's a cushion.
So you don't see a double-dip recession coming?
Well, I don't know. I can't predict the future. That's a healthy thing to have buffers in the economy. We've had nine recessions in World War II. We've got out every one of them. The system works.
If you could give one sentence of advice to scared investors right now, what would it be?
I think you ought to see some kids. You know, hire an 8-year-old, hire a 6-year-old. Just watch them. They don't know who Alan Greenspan is. They know about the shape of the yield curve. They're optimistic about the future. We'll be fine for the next 30, 40 years.
Let's hope you're right, Peter. Courage and persistence have worked in the past. There we do have to stop with thanks to Peter Lynch and our panelists.